Meeting of the Deerfield Conservation Commission, January 26, 2017, called to order 7 p.m. We have quite a bit on our schedule this evening, and we're going to start with a request for determination that has been filed for 247 Greenfield Road. Mr. Ceruta, if you'd like to come up and give us a quick overview, and then what we're going to do is, after you give us a fast overview, we weren't able to do a site visit because of the snow cover. We're going to continue the meeting until February 23rd, I believe it is. Somebody want to check their calendar?
Yes.
Thank you. February 23rd. So we appreciate your working with us on that.
Basically, what it is Brent Davis, who owns Ideal Movers and Storage over at Adley, made an offer on a piece of property at 247 Greenfield Road with the possibility of doing a self-storage building, an office building on that parcel. And basically, we're in just the feasibility portion of it. We've gone to the zoning board. They don't seem to be thrilled with self-storage, but we need to, in order to make the project feasible, the amount of money that's being invested in it and the purchase of the land, we've got to see how much of the land we possibly can use. And there is, toward the rear, not on this property, but this is the old railroad.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know what it is. Ditch, excavation.
And the old cut in back there.
In the back. We won't be doing anything to that, and there won't be any work within 50 feet of it. But if it's considered to be wetlands, then we would have to know if the Conservation Commission wants a filing and be whether you'd entertain anything in a buffer zone to that ditch. When I was out there, the ditch doesn't even have water. I don't even know what it is.
Mm-hmm.
It's just a major cut there. And it goes right up to an existing building on the neighboring property at Douglas Auction, so I don't know.
All right, so what we'll do is, we do want to do a site visit. So what we'll do is now is I'm going to make a motion to continue this meeting until 7 p.m. on February 23rd, 2017.
You got a second?
Second.
Aye.
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 Okay, so we're set.
In the interim, if you need anything from us, Chuck Dachi said that he would go out and try to do auger poles or whatever.
Well, we're quoting.
Or needs them, or I will attend your walk.
Yeah. Well, we'll give you a haul a week or so ahead of time.
In wooded area.
Yep.
Small portion of wooded area.
All right. What we'll do is we'll give you a haul or set up a time to get out there as a commission, to walk the property, take a look at the Mass GIS maps down at with DEP.
Okay.
And we'll take it from there.
Okay.
All right. Thank you. All right. One down. All right. We have some old business in front of us. The first on the agenda is the notice of intent for the proposed new Cumberland Farm site on 31 Elm Street. They're probably going to want you to use the microphone. So just for the record, we have taken the plans, sent them out for peer review. You have answered all of our engineers' questions.
Mm-hmm.
DEP is satisfied with that part of it. So there's one question I do have.
Yes.
That it was brought to my attention yesterday that there was a proposed change of the driveway area.
Yes.
In an area that may not be jurisdictional.
Yes.
But may affect stormwater management. How can we answer that question?
I can answer that question by showing you a sketch of an alteration of the driveways on Elm Street that we're considering. So I take it you're alluding to the fact that we got some feedback from the ZBA hearing last week.
I heard it from the building inspector's
okay.
office.
So we got feedback from the ZBA hearing last week, and essentially all is good with the exception of the proposed curb cut on Elm Street.
On Elm Street.
And in, it was advised, or we were advised to reconsider it in order to seek approval. So what we did is we committed to, in the essence of acting in good faith at that hearing to get some direction, we threw around some ideas that the ZBA would consider. And we've taken that back to our client, and we're at a point where we can share those. Nothing is definitive yet. There is some, I guess there's some options on either continuing or withdrawing and then resubmitting, but in acting in good faith, we wanted to try to finalize the permitting process as fast as we can. So I'm happy to show you the sketches or the sketch alternative that we are considering.
Yes.
So let me just set that up.
Yeah, I don't need those here.
What?
No, we were just making fun of us having to wear glasses.
Yeah. So this is the current site plan that was submitted in the original application, and it includes a one full access curb cut on Elm Street. This is the curb cut that the ZBA had asked for us to reconsider. So what we did was, and this is... this is still in draft format. We have not shown this to anybody except now for you guys. What we are considering is introducing a write-in only on Elm Street, substantially in the location of where the proposed access on Elm Street was, and then shifting that proposed access farther to the east. And that was at the request of the ZBA. They really wanted to get this proposed curb cut farther away from the intersection to reduce the potential conflicts of left turnouts. And we essentially pushed it as far as we can go. We've also introduced a sidewalk, which was a comment from the planning board at our December hearing, I believe. So all in all, there's a slight increase in impervious coverage. However, we're confident that there is still sufficient room in that stormwater infiltration area to accommodate that increase in impervious. So, in my opinion, this does not fundamentally change the plan or the operations of the plan pertaining to stormwater or the jurisdictional authority of you guys, but. Obviously, you know, should we receive an order tonight, we're happy to take a condition on should any plans be modified that we present those back to the commission.
Now, you got the permit for the state cut, that entrance?
This one?
Yes.
No, the MassDOT will not issue a permit until all local land use permits are in hand.
So that could change.
It will change, but we've gotten to a point where they preliminarily reviewed it. We've actually met on site with them. This was not our first proposal. Our first proposal was to have a write-in that was more drastic. So this geometry is a direct result from their initial feedback, both on site and via email. So we're comfortable with the location and the geometry and the design of that. However, as you alluded to, we're proceeding at our own risk, so to speak.
How many more square feet of impervious surface are we talking about? And the other question is, on that top entrance or exit, is that a jurisdictional area? I don't believe it is.
No, it's not. It's not jurisdictional. I mean, you can make an argument that we're hydrologically connected to your jurisdictional area, which is the 100-foot, which is right through here. But I can tell you that we're all the stormwater, all the watersheds are going to remain the same. Meaning, there is a small piece on Elm Street that drains onto Elm Street as it does today, or it'll be less in the proposed conditions, but everything else will come down and get collected through the drainage system that was on the revised proposal. So we're not even changing any of the proposed drainage structures, because the watersheds are not going to be changing as well. I would estimate that this, I guess in simplest terms, this curb cut here, or this driveway went from 24 feet wide to 30 feet wide to accommodate the truck turn. Because if you recall, the existing truck turn just went straight out on Elm Street. Now it has to make this serpentine movement, which for a tractor trailer, you just need some more space to do that. So this widened about 6 feet times the length of this. So you're looking at maybe 200 or 300 square feet here, plus whatever from here over on this new curb cut is. So, I mean, if I guess maybe 500 square feet, 500 to 600, 700 square feet.
What's the total square feet of the lot?
The total square feet is 2 acres, of which.
So now I'm going to have to ask you the same question. How many square feet is 2 acres?
Well, 2 acres is 85,000 square feet.
Okay.
So we're talking, de minimis increase in impervious coverage.
Can you flip back to that first one, just quick, please?
So essentially what we're doing is we're taking this piece, bringing it up here, so we'll call that a trade-off for argument's sake. We're widening this 6 feet, and then we're introducing this right in here.
Ben?
No questions for me.
Lou, you're the highway guy.
No, that seems reasonable there. It's not much of a change.
Yeah, I don't see it as being a significant change, but I hate...
The only thing, with the state, as long as you're confident with the state, because if you have to move it, now that changes everything if you have to move it to the south at all, that entrance.
This curb cut?
Yeah.
Yeah, any I'm sure there's a general condition in your order that any substantial change would need to go back to the commission. I guess what we'd be asking for in this case, should we choose to entertain the relocation of the full access drive and the introduction of the right-in only, provided that we submit new plans to the board and provide new stormwater calculations. Could that just be an administrative change as opposed to reopening up or requesting a modification of the order?
This is an unusual situation. That having had everything reviewed and approved,
I know.
And then to have...
Has Greg looked at any of this?
What's that?
Has Greg seen any of this?
He's seen the original plans.
Just nothing, not known.
This is new as of... I just heard about it yesterday.
Yeah, this is we did this today. We put the sketch today because I wanted to at least introduce this to the board.
Can we put that in an order of conditions?
We can put almost anything we want, honestly, Brian, into the order of conditions. It's just this has been kicking around a long time. I would like to get it off our agenda, but I want to make sure we do it in the right way. That the act is followed, the town's protected.
I think as long as the calculations, those are guaranteed to work out, if it changes it.
I can't hear you.
If the calculations work out after, that would be my only concern.
That would be my concern also, is that when we hit the final plan, that it is substantially the same as the plan that was reviewed by Greg Newman Engineering.
Yeah, what we can do is, so it's a catch-22, right? So as we understand it, planning board needs sign off from commission before they can close, because you technically advise them on the stormwater permit.
Yes.
So I think
your board is a very important first step.
Oh, we are very important.
So, however, I understand the conundrum that you're in is that, you know, you don't have a final plan in front of you right now.
Which I don't know in 20-something years if we've ever signed off on an order of conditions without a final plan that we could reference chapter and verse on the plan dated such and such a date submitted by.
Yeah, I mean, I guess I'm asking for you to consider us, should we go forward with the redesign of the Elm Street curb cuts, we would submit plans, reports, and I would put together a cover letter outlining what those changes were and a description of what they were.
I would want to put something in any order of conditions that invalidates the order of conditions if, in fact, and I'm not sure that's even legal, but if, in fact, it turns out that the calculations are not acceptable by our engineer or DEP,
sure,
that the order of conditions is null and void. And not being a lawyer, I'm not sure how to write that up. What do you think, Lou?
Well, technically, if they change the plans anyways, they got to go through the whole rigmarole anyway. So, I mean, if we're okaying this plan, strictly to this plan, if they change it, it's null and void anyways, isn't it?
I would guess so. But again, not a lawyer. And this is the first time that this has ever come up.
And I think, you know, just, you know, thinking this forward, I think the litmus test on what a non-substantial change should be is if we can successfully continue the grading as it's currently proposed, and it goes through the exact treatment trains that is currently proposed, and the water level in the pond does not exceed what it's designed to, you know, designed based on the outputs, I think that would constitute a non-substantial change.
That's the 247 Greenfield Road one, Brian. Well,
could you go back to the change?
Sure.
How close are you guys to making a decision on what you want your final plan?
Probably next week. And I think we have a planning board hearing coming up in 2 weeks.
It doesn't look like it's that significant that it should throw the whole thing off. But I would like to put some protection in for the Conservation Commission and the town, mm-hmm, and that we're meeting the standards of the Act.
Yeah, and we want that too. I mean, should we make this change and we find out that there is a substantial change, we want to come back to you too to protect ourselves.
So how are we going to write that up, Lou?
We're being asked on the first plan, though.
Well,
yeah, I mean, that's...
We really can't make a decision based on
that. Yeah, we can't even think about that, really.
What's that?
This one.
The second one. We're being asked.
I mean, this whole submission was for, and all the reviews were for the old plan.
Yep.
You know, so that's the only thing we can really... That's it. That's what's in question, isn't it?
Yeah, can we approve this potential plan based on what was submitted in the official plan?
I think the onus is on us. Is if and when we might make this modification, we need to submit materials that would prove that it would be non-substantial. And that's as I was thinking this forward, that would be how I would try to argue that this change is not substantial.
You would try and argue that. That's your job.
maintaining the previously proposed stormwater BMPs, the fact that it has not substantially changed the water level inside the infiltration system. So, like, all the drainage and the stormwater acts as currently proposed.
What's the...
I don't know. It seems like we're...
We're here to approve what was reviewed, the original plan.
By our engineer.
Right, and that's it.
And he's...
That's part of the...
They've met all the standards based on the original plan.
This isn't included at all.
No.
It's not even mentioned in the original.
This is a fly in the ointment.
Right, so... I don't know how that goes. If we approve...
I do know...
No one, this one, which might come or might not, but if it does come, then it's not been an accepted plan.
It will be, requires a separate filing.
Right. So you'd still have to, so that's the way it would have to be, I would think.
One of the things that was, when I talked to Mark Stinson at DEP today, one of the things he stressed was that we have a plan, a firm plan that we can then reference before. And frankly, ready to sign off on the original plan. We have all the paperwork done. DEP's happy with the original. DEP hasn't seen this either, have they?
No.
No.
Well, we could sign off on the current plan, and obviously any new plans, you could talk to Stinson tomorrow or something and see what his...
He won't be until Tuesday.
Oh, they're going to be a week out or anything before they even decide what the, if they're going to change. We could talk to Stinson and see what his thought process is on a minor change.
Well, it sounds like you're going to do this.
Not necessarily. No, not necessarily. That's a decision that's...
I'm not comfortable signing off on the order of conditions based on this. I am comfortable signing off on the order of conditions that we originally filed.
Sure.
With the stipulation that if you do make the changes, you must resubmit. Because this is highly unusual for us to have a plan that's not stamped and being asked to sign off. It puts us in a very compromised position, in my opinion.
Okay, yeah, and I'm not asking you to sign off on it. And if the solution is, if you so choose, you issue an order of conditions on the original plan, and then if and when this does go into effect, we seek a modification to the existing order.
What do you think?
Yeah, that... I mean, we shouldn't even be dealing with this.
No.
Any future change is going to be on the burden of them.
This is just something that might happen in the future, but right now it's what we got to sign off on and approve is
the original plan, which was accepted by our engineers, which is accepted by DEP, which we are happy to sign off on.
Right.
If you are happy having us sign off.
I guess in this, like, logistically, we're going to go through the same steps no matter what process we take. I think we're going to, if this goes into effect, we're going to redesign, we're going to submit. Mr. Newman's going to review it, hopefully sign off on it. And then I guess it's just a matter of process on an order of conditions continuing tonight. My request would be to issue the order on the current plan that's in front of you, and then if this goes into effect, then we seek a modification or a new NOI or what?
I would...
Yeah, that sounds...
That's... I would...
Yeah, I mean, it's really up to you, because...
Or if you request a continuance, we can continue until February 23rd.
Right, but...
Which is a...
If you think this, you're going to have to change it, then you might want to do that.
Yeah, the only issue is if we decide to keep the original plan...
Then we've wasted a month.
Yeah, and then planning board gets postponed. So I think I'd rather take the order and on the current plan, and then I guess I'm not understanding why we wouldn't be able to seek a modification to an existing order as opposed to submitting a new NOI.
Because this is uncharted territory for us, frankly. Okay. We have never... This is the first time in all the years I've done it that all of a sudden we're here to sign off on an existing plan that we've had reviewed, that's been... Our engineers have looked at it, the DEP's looked at it, everybody's copacetic, and now, boom, 24 hours ago, I have somebody say to me, oh, by the way, they may be coming to you tomorrow night with a revised plan. And it's like, that's not really the way things should be for us to sign off.
And by no means were we trying to
push this on the commission.
No, we're not, I'm certainly not feeling, but it's just, it's a different situation. And I want to make sure we protect the town and the act is followed to the best of our ability.
Sure, and I think if, you know, once we, if we get the order tonight and we reread the process on modification, if that's allowed, I think we'd want to go that route as opposed to submitting a new one. If the regulations.
If the regs permit it, then I don't have a problem doing that. So I'm going to make a motion, we sign off on the original order of conditions, the order of conditions on the original plan submitted and reviewed by our engineers.
DEP had conditions at all, or no?
Nope, we have the paperwork here to sign off on.
No, that.
So if that works for you guys.
Really there.
Yeah, that doesn't really exist.
That doesn't really.
Yeah, I think we want to, you know, obtain this local approval tonight.
This is like an informational meeting.
Yeah, this is FYI.
Yeah. But it really has nothing to do with this. But you have the option of saying, you know, sign off on the original one and then you're good to go.
Let's get the right paperwork here. Give me a second.
Were there any special conditions that?
Okay. No. Priscilla and Mark had gone over all the conditions today to put this together. And we do have our report from the engineer that you guys did do a very good job on the modifications that he requested, so appreciate that. Double sign.
Double sign.
Yeah. Well, that wasn't fun, was it?
It was fun. It's.
So we'll get this all taken care of tomorrow. Okay. Priscilla will get it out to you guys. And
okay.
So you're good to go.
Then we'll see what happens
so
from there.
Once we get it, we record it.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. Great.
Okay. Well, thank you. Oh, they're aware of all that.
That's DA, I think.
What's that?
Is this DA's paperwork? The memo's attached to it, or Deerfield Academy.
Oh. No, my bad on that one.
Put your glasses on.
I was going to say I got to put my glasses on. Shut up, Luke. Yep. No. We'll work out that. I did that on purpose, Brian.
That's fine.
I'm just testing. Yeah. All right. All right. Thanks again. Next on our agenda, we have a couple of issues. We have a notice of intent for phase two, 27 Albany Road and 4 Little Meadow Road, Deerfield Academy Hockey Rink. Construction of the field house and hockey rink continued from the previous meeting, result of peer review and other updates. So, how are you?
Want to do the NOI first and then the RCOC? Is that what we're...
However you want to do it.
Okay.
You might want to bring that closer.
Yeah. Got a few folks from Ty and Bond here on behalf of Deerfield Academy.
Yep.
Jessica Roberts, wetland scientist. Chuck Croce, project manager, and Andrew White is professional engineer. And basically, we had the first hearing in November.
Mm-hmm.
And then at that hearing, you all decided you wanted to hire the third party reviewer for the stormwater. So Greg Newman has reviewed the project. We met with him on site on January 6th. He provided comments on January 14th. So you all have the response to comments packet that was submitted on the 24th, I think.
Yeah, we do not have, and I, as I said to you in my emails today, that we tried to call, we tried to email to get some sort of, yeah, everything's good, everything's not good, whatever. So we really don't have the final report from Greg to be able to say we're good to go.
Okay, so that you had mentioned in an email that was the paperwork that, you said there was some paperwork that needed to be completed before.
Right, we don't have it.
Okay, so you need final response from him.
We do not have that.
Okay.
And I will say that talking to DEP, they were happy with the changes that you submitted to them. So Mark was, but at the same time, again, it goes back to our last customer, that if we don't have the final say from our guy, it's very hard for us to say we can sign off on this.
Okay.
So, but as we discussed, and I'm going to bring this up to the board, because there is a time issue for tearing this rink down, that perhaps we could meet, assuming that Greg gets us all the information we need, on February, I believe it's 2nd. Thank you very much. That we could meet February 2nd to do a quick review of Greg's engineering report of any modifications, and then sign the order of conditions. So again, it's kind of a fluid situation, and we'd like to work with you as best we can, but so if the second works, we can kind of move on from there.
Yeah, that should be fine.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay, so at least that puts us a step ahead of the game.
Okay, that would be great.
And we also have your request for a certificate of compliance for phase one. And to answer your question that you posed, I called Mark and he had already left till Tuesday.
Okay.
To try and get some clarification on that. So we really won't know until next week. Can we? This is the first, again, this is another first that I really don't need.
Yeah, and I guess, so my email to you is in the spirit of, I know the DEP comments on the phase two NOI, DEP had said, you know, the applicant should submit a request for certificate of compliance for phase one. And that, in my previous conversations with Mark, it's an administrative request to clear out the deed for any project before something else begins, but there are many, many projects for which there are unclear deeds, and this is a new, I think, administrative process that DEP is recommending.
Oh, we've had projects that, we have a project going on in town right now that goes back 14, 16 years.
Yeah.
So I understand where they're coming from. It cleans up a lot.
It does. And so I guess what we were requesting is that the issuance of that be not linked to the start of construction for phase two, that there be a condition in the permit for phase two that says, we recognize the applicant has submitted this request for phase
one. I would hope that we'd be able, when construction doesn't start till mid-March, right?
Late February.
Late February. Well, hopefully we can get out there before that such time and take a look at the place and then sign off for you if the snow clears a little bit.
Yeah, but again, I think we should clarify with Mark, but, you know, just to make sure that those things should not be linked to each other.
Well, if we're going to meet February 2nd, we could clarify both of those at the same time.
Yes.
Correct?
That would be
the plan, I would hope, to make sure that we've got all our T's.
And I know you guys understand that the more flexibility we can give Deerfield Academy to start sooner in February, the better, just because it relates to how the schedule for the students and mobilization.
It's all about public safety. That's what we're about.
Yeah.
So.
Okay. Would you like us to go through some of the revisions or hold?
If you don't mind, we'll take a few minutes to go through them.
Sure.
So we're up to speed. So when we come in here on the 2nd, we're not going through rehashing old ground, that we've got a pretty good understanding of where we are.
Okay. So Greg made a number of comments in his report, and it really kind of boils down to just three basic changes to the plans. First comment he made was, we had surface drains and some roof drains tied together, and then
into the underground infiltration system. He was concerned that the surface drains that are out in the grass area and drain some of the paved areas would overload or provide sediment into the infiltration system. So he recommended that the surface drains be disconnected from the underground infiltration and just the roof drainage be put into that structure. So that's what we did, and how we did it was we are installing a 12-inch pipe right along the face of the proposed building, and all the roof drains come right out through the north side. So this one pipe right here will collect all the roof drainage. It ties right into the incoming manhole that goes into the infiltration system, and it fills up, and it makes its way back out and to the discharge point. And then the existing yard drains, which are here, 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 these were actually, there was a pipe that connected to the first structure in the system. We disconnected and ran its own pipe all the way downstream to this point. And then that discharges separately into our, just before the bridge. So that was the main change that occurred. The second thing he had a concern about was just to confirm that where we discharged to the wetland, that our velocities were below 3 feet per second, because he was worried about scouring.
Yep.
So before we had this discharge connected to an existing one, it had its own riprap, so it had its own discharge of the pipe with some riprap. And then when we relooked at the calcs, we were a little over 3 feet per second, so we just disconnected it. And we had its own, we discharged to grade with a flared end section and new riprap. So this is well under 3 feet per second now. This location. And the other spot is right here, this pipe, which discharges right here to an existing riprap splash pad. And after you're looking at that, we were again slightly over 3 feet per second. So we just increased the pipe size from 8 to 15 inch, and that reduced that one down well below 3 feet per second. So there's no erosive velocities of those two outlets.
I got a question. Now, did you say you have two pipes now running down to that outlet, down in the field?
Right here?
Yeah.
There's still just one. The two pipes, there's one pipe here coming out of the infiltration system.
Yeah.
That's the roof flow. And then the surface drains bypass.
Now, why aren't you combining those two?
They're at different elevations.
That much of a...
So I had to go farther downstream. Yeah. Otherwise, I'd have to replace this entire line. So it was easier to put in a shallower line and connect further down here.
Oh, so you're connecting both of them down at the bottom?
Yeah, both right here in this manhole.
Okay.
Yeah.
It just looks like you have two pipes all the way over to there.
All the way over here?
Yeah.
No, this is just one right here.
Okay. Yeah. Just looked like you had two manholes. I couldn't figure out.
It does look though.
Why you would do that.
Oh, this right here, that's a retaining wall. If you're looking at that.
That's okay.
Yeah.
That does look similar.
But then there's right below, connected to it looks like a manhole, right?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
You got three manholes, it looks like, from here.
Yeah, that's not a manhole. It's a manhole, water drain, and that's a CES unit, water quality unit, short piece of pipe, and then a flared end section, and then a riprap anti-scour pad.
Those are the main issues that Greg brought up.
Yeah.
All right, so why don't we do this then? Why don't we meet on the 2nd at 7 o'clock. Make sure we've got all the paperwork put together before that. I'll stay in contact with you and Greg and Mark and make sure that everybody's on the same page, and then we can put this to bed.
Excellent.
Anything else? Or you guys have anything?
No.
I just want to understand the schedule. So if we meet next Thursday, you guys sign off.
I can't hear a word you're saying, I'm sorry.
If we meet next Thursday and you guys sign off, there's a, my understanding is a 10-day
appeal. 10-day appeal period, yes.
And then after that, we record it, and then we
record it. You record it right away, and then the 10-day,
okay.
10-day appeal period kicks in, and don't often see too much, too many appeals in that. I wouldn't do anything.
No, I'm just trying to understand. So we record it even before the 10 days are up.
I believe so. A lot of questions I've never had asked me before. This is
supposed to be asking your consultant.
Why aren't you asking her? She's a, I'm a bag salesman.
But we will, I will find that out before we meet on the 2nd. Find out what the deal is on that.
Great, thank you.
Thank you.
Appreciate the flexibility and the timing.
All right, so old business from our last meeting. We had the Conway Road installation of a culvert that has been withdrawn. So that's done. We have to sign off on the Boatin Pond Road. The town has decided they'll go straight to notice of intent on that. The replacement of those crush pipes.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
So let me make sure I get the right one. I don't want to test Brian again.
It just didn't, like, usually.
No, I'm glad you caught that.
Yeah, I was wondering why I signed it too. But...
The area described in the reference plan is an area subject to protection under the Act. Removing, filling, dredging, altering the area requires the filing of a notice of intent. Part number one. So.
Very positive, huh?
Yeah, we don't get too many of those.
Positive number one?
Yep.
Positive is negative.
There you go. Yes, it is.
Don't do this to me. This has not been an easy meeting. Okay, we our budget, under new business, our budget submission is the same as it was last year, which is $800, which we have not spent at all. And then we continued our request for determination for 4 Greenfield Road because of the snow cover. That's the little house right down by across from Dunkin' Donuts by the dollar store there. It's for the, they want us to give them a either wetlands just to make sure that they're ready to go if and when.
So we're just going to continue with
it? Continue. Yeah, I talked to Greg Gardner, was the applicant, and it continued to February 23rd. Okay, we've got a couple of comments, requests for comments from the Planning Board. And the ZBA has a request for comments on a height variance for 100 Railroad Yard. So let's get...
I assume that's the Salt City deal?
Yeah. So the... As far as the... Poor Greenfield Road, very hard for us to comment since we don't really have anything to comment on yet because we haven't been out to see it.
That'll be continuing comments till
yeah.
23rd.
Yeah. And I don't have any problem with 100-foot tower down in on the railroad yard, which is a little bit above our...
No. Oh, that's a good
town zoning, so
no comment.
So that's that.
No comment.
Minutes and mail?
Yep. We do have a letter in front of us, though, that under this, the going over the mail, we have a letter from the law firm of Ziomek and Ziomek down in Amherst, Mass., addressed to the Conservation Commission. Basically, what it is a letter saying that a notice from Arlene Tierney, Doug Tierney, Charlene, and Edward Galinsky, that they want to remove a parcel of land from 61A down on Whitmore Ferry Road. And basically, they want to know if the town, in fact, wants to have first crack at it. I don't think the Conservation Commission really should be making a decision like that. I think that should go to the Select Board. So I'm going to recommend that we just pass this buck over to the Select Board. Let them handle it.
I'll second it.
Aye.
Aye.
So that's that. That was an interesting piece of mail. And we've got.
Is it that easy to do? You know? You don't know anything?
I am Mickey the Dunce tonight. And we've got a letter from the Corps of Engineers regulatory about the Cabot Tap Separation Project over in Montague that impacts a little bit of over by Stillwater where the town, where they put in the new fence and the gate up on that, across the road from that. So it's more of a informative, this is what's going on type of letter. So that is our mail. So take a look at the minutes from our previous meeting.
Except for me. I was not here.
Oh, that's right. You were absent. And does anyone know of, we could use a fifth member. If anybody knows somebody who's got some good common sense and is willing to volunteer.
That is in short supply.
What, common sense or volunteering?
All of the above.
Looks good to me.
I'll make a motion to accept the minutes as presented.
Second.
Aye.
Aye. All right. There being apparently no other business to attend to unless anybody has any concerns or then I would make a motion to adjourn at looks to be about 7:48.
I'll second.
Aye.
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 Aye. We're out.